And we welcome you back to another episode of the TriUnity series with Dr. Shmuel Asher. I'm Randy Moggins from offplanetradio.com. We're going to thread through some concepts today under a kind of a follow-up to the previous show, which was the Simulacrum Building the Perfect Beast show that you've probably already heard. If you haven't, go listen to it. You may want to listen to it again before or after you hear this show today. But there's some concepts and some thoughts that we want to go through in this show that entail understanding what is going on inside of this matrix reality. The building of this construct, this artificial soul trap construct, however we want to define that, it seems to be a common core with people who have these weird experiences. And as Shmuel and I have kind of kicked information back and forth between each other, I think we found yet another thread which kind of moves out of the normal stream of what we've been talking about relative to the book, but in a way it's all related, because it all has to do with how we deal with what I'll just call raw evil and this time when they are attempting to pull us into a soul net. And with that, Shmuel Asher, welcome back.
Hey, Randy. Thanks for having me.
So where we kind of begin the narrative, we'll kind of pivot off of the last show. But I know there's some things that you and I have talked about that have to do with some of these experiences that people have had. These experiences in a lot of ways are very similar to what we've talked about on my Off Planet Radio and Exotica shows for about 7 years now, under different headings, because we've dealt with things like extraterrestrial abductions, the Greys, the Draco, and things like that. And then we've also dealt with military abductions, which goes into black operations such as MK Ultra, the mind control programs that have been running since the post-World War period. And then all of those things are sort of tentacles of something else that's been going on around us.
Right. And I guess I'll start out with I'll start out with a minor disclaimer here before we get into this. But I think it's important for everybody to understand that, I've solely worked through an academic level. I've never been, one that is lends himself to what I would call Christian superstitions and things like that. I tended, like a lot of people tend, I tended to kind of look or poo-poo kind of to use French way to just blow off things I heard about people coming to me with their abduction stories and things like this. I tend towards the science a little bit more, and really my what I've always endeavored to do, or I was taught to do, as I've said in other shows, was to really dive back as far and as deep as I could into the ancient past and find whatever the oldest bone was, as I tend to say, the oldest truth in order to work back forward and find out, you know, where, what superstitions were piled on and things. That's how I've worked. So I just want people to understand that I don't and never have been drawn towards the super spiritualized or superstition end of a lot of the stuff. And everyone also knows that I don't believe in aliens at all. I don't believe they exist at all as aliens from other planets or other places. You know, I understand that we have gone through the other shows that people can listen to again, or I'm pretty clear on that I believe these are all machinations of the ones who are against the Creator, what we call a fallen or whoever. They might be beings that were created by them, the way they created these Trinity Six bodies, but only for that, for their own use. They're not from some other place, which I think is very important to this conversation today, because that's a narrative that gives people a reason for what's happening to them. It's a narrative that allows, that we've had through Hollywood and through government sources and all. It's all BS, but it's a very important narrative for them because it covers up a lot of what they're doing. It covers up a lot of their technology that people see when they test it or they, you know, driving around in their little alien crafts. And it also, more importantly, gives all the abductee people who believe they've been abducted or have been abducted by military operations, like you're saying, or the other Archon operations, gives them something to cling to after it all, right? Gives them that alien narrative, which leads them nowhere, right? It doesn't lead them to anything important. It doesn't lead them to understand the truth of the matrix of the false holoverse that they're creating somewhere else and wherever they take you, which is what we're going to talk about now, right? So in saying that, just so people understand, this is a first time for me, what I'm about to get into, and it's not something I really know anything about, except that all of the information I have from, you know, 30-plus years of study, which has brought me to this point, has allowed me to see, like Randy's been saying, what this other false matrix is, and that it does exist, like we talked about in Show 6, and how they're formulating it, how they're populating it with first the attributes of this world, or people's houses, people's cars, people's trees, grass, everything. But what's the next step is to populate it with people, with souls, into a matrix that they can't get out of, a matrix that they will be finally completely cut off from the Creator. I think, Randy, in that thing you sent me, what you wrote, it kind of gets into that they're... when people are pulled into that, when souls are pulled into that false binary matrix, that they become null, right? And I thought that was pretty neat how you put that, because what is the expanse? What is outside of the origin of all creations, of wherever these creations are? What's outside? The expanse, nothingness, the null, right? So that's, I guess, akin to where these souls will end up in the end. So with that said, I guess I will just get into the, unless you want to... You know,
yeah, well, let me just insert here the article that I sent you. We'll post this out with a link that will go along with, you know, this program for people to see. But it basically was a stream off of an idea with the Mandela effect, having to do with these weird memes that have been cast out on largely through the internet, but people have very specific memories about things that now appear to have been interrupted or changed in some way. And so in examining that, I began to look at the effects of time inside of this matrix, which is a binary matrix system, and how time is basically threaded, much like the hyper-threading that goes on in a computer where memory shot off of the core processor and then splits out into different tasks simultaneously running. So at some point, what you have are you have these streams of data that are being shot out into the matrix itself, and they've been edited, they've been changed, they've streamed through other different parallel timelines in ways that tiny details change. And, you know, it is small details a lot of times where people begin to notice the ripples on the surface of the matrix itself. And it's kind of cognitive dissonance at that point because you're not sure. And that's part of the game. That's part of the deception, is to keep us rather unbalanced, unsure of our own reality. So this article will go out with that and some other material that Shmuel has put together as well. But let's go ahead and talk about, you know, the things that people have been reporting to you.
Well, and again, I wasn't, I was telling Randy that I very, you know, didn't really want to get into this personally on any personal level, because of my past beliefs and what people were going through. But unfortunately for me, I think I have to kind of lay this out there and bear it all kind of as a warning, really, because I wasn't sure what was going on when it happened to me, but I was absolutely sure it was happening. And the way I found out later that it was happening to others is what gives this, I think personally, gives this credibility, which is why I'm coming forth on this show and getting into it, because of two major things. People have to understand that this is happening, and they have to connect it to the false matrix that they have already said that they're building to retrieve and enslave the souls that are here, however many that is, and also to give people the ammunition they need to stay out of it. So with that, I'll try to go through it a little quickly. This, just to let people know, this happened over five nights. They weren't consecutive. Possibly every other night for about 2 weeks. And that's about what it was. And what would happen was, and like I say, this is, you know, everybody knows what dreams are like. Everybody has occasionally has very vivid dreams, which I've had. I know the difference. I even many times know when I'm dreaming, that I'm, you know, dreaming. I think a lot of people have that same experience. This was vastly different. This was a complete break from dreaming. What happened was that I would go to sleep, and I literally popped in somewhere else. Is the best way to explain it. I went to sleep and I woke up, or not woke up, but I actually just existed somewhere else. I was me. I didn't see myself, but I knew I was me, and I had all my knowledge, all my understanding, and immediately when I was there inside a house, like an old Victorian type of house, there were other people around me. They all seemed to be speaking and talking, and the ramble, kind of meandering around, not understanding what was going on as well. I did perceive that. all of what this, I knew this really wasn't a dream, because you can actually feel it being there. Your consciousness was actually there. And I also immediately, as soon as I popped in and looked around, knew it was wrong. I knew something was wrong. I knew I shouldn't be there, and possibly was only there for a few minutes the first time. and really, really disliked it and pretty much unconsented to being there. I remember thinking to myself, because I wasn't speaking to anyone, I was ignoring everyone. I know there were people trying to get my attention, but I was ignoring them because they didn't seem to have any answers. They also seemed to be milling around, not understanding why they were there. But they also weren't leaving. And within a couple of minutes the first time, I left. And when I woke up immediately in my bed, fully awake. But I guess the best way to describe it is, you know, when people have these dreams, I know everyone's probably had them, of falling, that jolt you feel right before you wake up, that's what I felt every time right before I woke up. I felt like I literally fell from the sky. Not like my body hit the bed, but something hit the bed. Like, I don't know, maybe my soul falling back in. Again, I've never experienced anything like this before. I've never even spoke to many people about these kind of things before because I tended not to, you know, get into it. It's not my field. It's not what I know about. So, you know, this is all X-Files to me. So I woke up immediately and was cognizant that I was awake, right? Because I woke up, I was fully awake, not groggy at all, not like I ever went to sleep. And I immediately, upon waking, you know, sat up to make sure I was here. I was at my house. I remember the first night I got up after it happened, walked around the house, you know, to make sure I was here. Checked on my son, make sure he was here. And that was pretty much it. I thought, wow, that was freaky. I thought maybe it was a dream. I don't know. I knew it wasn't. I knew it wasn't, but I was trying to talk myself into it that it probably was just a dream. And then it happened a second time, same house, third time, same house, stayed a little longer, different events going on in with people there, different people there. I also have to say that the color of everything was a little bit, not black and white, but you know, not technicolor.
It was off.
Yeah, it was a little darker or faded or something. Like it you know, I was outside on the porch of this house as well, talking with people trying to get my attention to talk to me. I wasn't paying attention to anyone. Every time I popped in, I don't know who they were talking to before I popped in, but when I popped in, there were people standing there talking to me. And I was looking out through eyes and immediately knowing I wasn't supposed to be there. I immediately knew I was somewhere else. I immediately knew all of this while I was there. This was not like any dream I've ever had. I've had many vivid dreams. I've had dreams that have led me to truths that I know were given to me by my Creator, and I know what they're like. And this was not it. This was, and I just can't express it enough or give it enough texture, but I can just tell you that I'm a very super rational individual, and I think scientifically, and I, like I said, I'm not prone to believing there's a ghost or an evil entity on every doorknob. So it's very opposite of my personality to have this happen and to come out of it. By about day three, every other day or so that this happened, by about the third event, it did start to mess with me while I was awake. That's how I knew it wasn't, also how I knew it wasn't a dream, because it was really starting to mess with my personality. I was agitated. I'm very hard to scare, okay? Mainly because I am absolutely convinced of who I am and where I go after this. So, but I have to say, by the third event, by the third time, the first time, like I say, was shocking. You know, I didn't take in much the first time because I immediately knew I was somewhere else. I immediately understood it was me, and I immediately knew I wasn't supposed to be there. And the only thoughts the first time was how to get the hell out, because I absolutely knew I wasn't supposed to be there. And by the second time, I also felt the same way, but I started taking more in, looking more around, walking through rooms. And by the third time, it got even more involved. But I didn't stay very long. And I knew to get out, and I knew how to get out. And as soon as I unconsented to being there, I was gone. Instantly, in a nanosecond, I woke up again. So by that third time, though, I got to say, like I'm telling you, it started messing with me, even consciously. So I was actually a little scared to go to sleep because I knew something was going on. I knew somehow my soul was being taken somewhere else, was being transported somewhere else. And many would say, well, then there goes your whole free will concept. Well, no, that's not exactly true, because people have to remember that we consented to their plan a long time ago. We consented without understanding all the
exactly.
fine.
Exactly.
So the fine print is, guess what? I can take your butt wherever I want. And when you get there, how long you stay is up to you. See? And that's what was happening, and I knew that's what was happening. I just felt it. I knew that's what was happening. So, and believing what I tell you, Randy, and everyone else, that anyone who actually knows me personally would absolutely believe this, because they know my personality is the antithesis of this stuff. So that anyone who knows me, and there's a lot out there who do, who listen to these shows, will immediately understand that I'm not messing around here, and I'm only putting this out there as a warning. So by the fourth time, I was really the fourth time was again same house. It seemed like even more people. There were people out on the street. It was in a residential neighborhood of old homes, it seemed. And it was a city far off in the distance. And that's all I knew. I didn't go far from the house at all, not even to the street. But it had a large walk-around porch, and so I was able to see a lot. And so by the fourth time, I didn't feel comfortable, but I figured while I'm there, I should do some recon, So I did that, came back, and then that day, later on that day, I got what I would consider a fairly frantic phone call. Not frantic, but just a phone call from a woman I know very well, who I consider to be a sister. And she, again, is a very down-to-earth person, very wise person, lived through the 60s, the whole thing. She's got a lot under her belt. Very spiritual person, learned from me and others. And she called up, and she felt, she sounded very, very freaked out, just freaked out, just probably another day or so unconsolable, I would guess, had she not called. She called me, and she started telling me a story for about 45 minutes, which was nearly identical to the story I just told all of you. In fact, it was one of the few times that I hardly talked for 45 minutes, which I know is hard to believe. So I didn't talk because I swear a part of me wanted to think she was messing with me somehow. because of the detail she was giving me of what was happening to her when she went to sleep. And I just could not freaking believe what I was hearing. And then she told me she called. She wasn't going to call, but that she decided to call because, you know, she's scared. And also because two other people, another man, another woman, that she knows very well, had talked to her a day or so before, freaking out over the exact same thing, giving her nearly the same details of what they felt was going on, that this is what happened, that they're afraid to fall asleep, you know, So I could not believe what I was hearing. I let her talk. And at the end, towards the end, when she was asking me what I thought about it, that's when I told her the exact same story, which she just told me, and what I'm telling you. And that really, you know, it flipped us both out. Because neither of us could believe that we're having the identical experience, especially since her experience was from a different perspective than mine. She wasn't in the house. She was walking down the street, the middle of the street, I believe she told me, of all these old Victorian homes and all the colors of the trees and the grass and the houses. Everything was off, a little faded, but that she absolutely knew it was there. She even said there was a city in the background. You know, and I had no words. I just couldn't, you know. And again, that's a very rare thing for me. So, this is when I knew that I was absolutely right, that this was not a dream, that it was something that was actually, I'm going to say physically happening, but obviously it wasn't physical. it was spiritually happening. Okay, but since your soul is an eternally living entity, then that's your true if you want to use the word physicality, that's your true self. So that's what was being taken, transported, not abducted, because again, like I say, at some point we agreed to this stuff, so, and agreed to everything that was coming, and agreed to the fact that it was whatever we agreed to was a living document, which they change and refigure, reconfigure as they go. What we do when we get there, that's the meat of it, so to say. So I knew then at that point that this was a real thing, and what really freaked us out, because we were both talking and said, well, you know, she wanted to know what's my opinion. How does she get out of it next time she goes? And, you know, all I know is that what I felt, you know, what I was thinking when I was there, and as soon as I really started thinking about it, I don't even remember saying it while I was there the first four times. But I was thinking that I did not consent to being there. And as soon as I really gave that thought or projected it, enough, strongly enough, boom, I was gone. Okay? So I told her, I said, well, first of all, you know, I think when you pop in there next time, that you absolutely have to outwardly, with your mouth, express that you do not consent to being there at all, and you're unconsenting to the program, whatever you have to say, and hopefully that should be it. And I told her that if that doesn't seem to be working fast enough, then I said the only other thing I know to do is to use the Creator's name. That's the only thing I know how to do. Of course, Christians would use Yeshu's or Jesus, whatever, but and maybe that would work as well. I don't know. I'm not prone to having that on the tip of my tongue, but that you know, that's what I told her. Now, she was smarter than me, because she didn't want it to happen anymore. She, I believe, at some point that day or that night, prayed to Hia and invoked his name, invoked that power, invoked that protection, and unconsented, said that she did not consent to having her soul lifted, transported, taken, however you want to put it, to anywhere at any time for any reason that was outside of the creator's use, all right? That wasn't, you know, connected to his tether, so to say. And it stopped for her, from what I've heard. That was it. It never happened again. This was about 2 months ago, a month and a half ago. Me, you would think that's what I would have done, but I usually have so much stuff going on, I probably wasn't thinking about it. Worked till 2 or 3 in the morning, as I usually do, and then crashed. And went to sleep, and that night was unbelievable. That night, which would be the fifth occurrence for me, I woke up. I just didn't wake up. I keep saying that, but I just... It's like you just appear somewhere else. I just don't have another way to explain it. And I my eyes opened, and I'm standing at what seems to be the far end of the most enormous Orthodox building, church, whatever you want to call it, that I've ever seen. I've also been in the Vatican briefly because I couldn't stay in there, but I know what it looks like and how big it is. This looked at least twice as large. I don't even know if there's a building like this on the earth. I don't know if there's a building bigger than the Vatican on the earth. I'm not sure. But this was enormous. I was standing in the aisle as they are, with their large pews on both sides. I must have been at the end where the entrance would be. It looked to be shaped like a T, where there'd be entrances on right and left, and then where I was. And just to give you some scale, I'm going to say that from where I was standing to where the rabbi or priest or whoever stands at his little podium there looked to me to be 150 yards. It was enormous. And I remember looking left, looking around right. There were 3 to 4 other people standing right to my right. They were talking. I always got the sense whoever was around me that they were freaked out. They didn't know what to do. They didn't know where they were, why they were there, and all this. So this all happened in only a matter of about 20 seconds because I didn't intend to stay, because now I know what's going on. Okay, so I'm standing there. I'm looking around. It's massive pews. It had to be, 75 yards wide at the very least. And I looked up, and it was a massive dome. It was so big, and it was just, it was kind of dark in there, and it was like candles everywhere. So I'm guessing Catholicism or Greek Orthodox or something, some Babylonian religion. And it was just, I remember just being amazed at the enormity of it, and looked around for about 15, 20 seconds, caught myself, and then I used his name loudly, which echoed in the place, and said that I did not consent to being there. And as soon as I did that, I had woke up, you know, with that jolt in my bed. I was sitting up at that point, and I was back. And then I did what the other woman did, was I earnestly asked to unconsent from that program and never have that happen to me again. And since then, it's never happened. So it's going on about 2 months. It has not happened again. So I believe that's the key, and I believe two things. I believe what's going on here, and why I decided, after a lot of thought, giving this a lot of thought, about coming out publicly and telling anyone this happened to me personally, is because it has to be happening to other people. And I fear that the trap is that they have populated this other matrix. They're getting close to finishing it. And what they're probably doing is, through technology, somehow ramping up their system from time to time and pulling souls into it. Now, like I said, it seemed like the people that were in this house, the four times I wound up in the house versus the Vatican, whatever it was, those people seemed to be there before I arrived and were obviously there, as far as I know, after I unconsented and left each time. So I started thinking about it. I'm thinking that what they're doing is because you have to consent. So if most of the people that this is happening to, possibly worldwide, I would guess worldwide, however many that is, I fear that they, not having the depth of knowledge that someone like me has or you have, that being pulled into that, they'll just continue to allow it to happen because they're getting up every morning or every night thinking it's a dream, a very weird dream, very vivid dream, you know, and they keep winding up in the same place. Why is this happening? You know, and, oh, it's a weird dream, oh, whatever, and that's it. They don't give it much more thought. Now, the problem with that is that's tacit consent. So if they are purposely, you know, like an IV, it's slow at first, then they could speed up the drip. And that's what I think is happening. They're pulling people in, souls in, to slowly get them acclimated to it, not knowing to on consent, not knowing any particular name that saves, okay, not understanding that it's not a dream. They stay longer and longer each time. And I think that's what those people were, because they all seemed like they were confused, but they didn't seem overly alarmed. And, you know, I was immediately, a nanosecond there, I was alarmed because I knew it was real. Well, in the sense that my consciousness was there and it was interacting with another place that I had never seen. So in that, yeah, but if you just believe it's a dream, a reoccurring dream, which is why they would take you back to the same place, because to you, it's just a reoccurring dream. Okay, just like the alien narrative, which allows people, this to happen to people in other circumstances, having other surroundings, the false alien narrative allows them to wake up, allows them to commiserate with other people who have had this alien abduction, and it gives them a path to travel, okay? It's a path to nowhere. It leads you to nothing except for more questions, but it surely never leads you to understand that your soul is being extracted and moved to another place in order to acclimate you to being there. So the fear is that this is happening to people. They're just believing it's just an ongoing dream state, which is tacit consent. So, you know, maybe I was there for a minute or two, three minutes the first time, and other people might have been there 2, 3, 5 minutes the first time. Second time they might be there 10 minutes. Next time they might be there 2 hours. After a while, guess what? They're going to keep you there. And your body, laying in your bed, is going to be in a coma because it's pretty much disconnected from your soul. So maybe somebody put you on life support, but you're not coming back. And that's what the fear is for me. When I thought about this, I thought, wow, anyone else this is happening to that doesn't have the knowledge base, the immediate understanding to know that all this exists, this is what their end game is, and possibly they've started ramping it up. Maybe they have enough of it filled in. They have enough of it populated with your basic topography, right? That they can start slowly pulling things. You know, in my book, when I said this in the book, people would come back to me, like we've talked about, Randy, and people would say, well, you know, how if they want to get us into an alternate reality, into a bit-based reality, then just because it looks the same or whatever, how are they going to get people to consent to that? See, that's the rational mind thinking, you know, come on, who's going to consent to that? And I immediately go to what I know, and what I know is how they work, and how they work has always been based on fear. So I look at the other narratives. I look at the alien narrative. That's a big one. I look at, you know, the alleged Project Bluebeam that can show you things in the sky and whatever. I look at the aircraft that they have that appear to look like the alien aircraft that they show you in all the movies, which is a narrative to get you thinking that's what they are. So I immediately would tell these people that have asked me this question that they're probably going to mock some alien invasion and scare holy crap out of everyone to the point that, you know, people are just so freaked out. And then it's pretty easy to say, hey, we have a way out of here. We have a way to save you. You know, just, I don't know, run through this Stargate, or just, you know, put this chip in your head, or whatever. You know, I'll put this little Star Trek pin on your chest, and, you know, you'll be beamed up, Scotty, and whatever. They'll have a way out, but the way out will be to this place. That's what I was originally thinking, that I look at the past to judge the future, right? How they have always worked is how they will work. But, you know, after this experience, I'm thinking somebody might have smartened up big time. And they're going for the more sublime technique because it has to be based on consent. You know, is consent to run through a Stargate to go to another alleged reality, another planet, okay, after being scared shitless, is that actually consent? I mean, it is, but it sure is borderline, and it's teetering on that razor's edge of free will, right? So
I, you know, there's a couple of things that come into play here, and because you've had these experiences recounted, and you've also experienced it yourself, there's a couple aspects to this. When you begin to profile a phenomenon, you know, the broader the field that you sample from, the greater you can begin to assess the data that's coming in. As you know, what I have done for 7 years on this show is talk to people who have had experiences related to what they called the extraterrestrial abduction experience, military abductions, people who have wound up in strange dimensional transitions, out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences, and the commonality in all of this is that it appears to me and to many others that there is a trap that's set, and the trap is largely to make something that you are either attractive to or fearful of alluring in a way that it can pull you in. It appears to me that we have equal levels of emotional vibration, energetic going on. So what you fear or what you strongly desire are both equal in energetic. So they can use either side of the equation. And then you wind up in a place that you look at it and it just feels off. And that's been a real common perception that people who have experienced any kind of abduction activity, everything from extraterrestrials to extra dimensionals to the MyLabs thing, which is creepy and weird underground bases, they note that that it's off. They sense that it's off. And the other side of this is, and you and I talked about this before, that in this matrix realm, consent, tacit consent, is the default. We've in some way consented or had consented for us. And let's not forget that a lot of the people who were part of military intelligence black operation projects were placed there by even well-meaning parents. They basically signed them in. This was my experience in as a child when I was turned over for testing and subsequent, shall we say, special education opportunities, that in fact there was an express consent that was given by the parent on the part of the consenting minor, and as a result of that, it was never interrupted. There was a flow of consent that streamed the whole way back until the point where the child itself is able to do a revocation, which, you know, some of the people that I've talked to, in fact, did at some point, even if it was just as simple as leave me the F alone. So, you know, what you're talking about here, I'm kind of magnifying this out into a broader scale because of the listening audience itself, except to say that there's a commonality and experience that says there's definitely something going on here.
Right. And, you know, and just like I expressed in a book that, and maybe I didn't detail it out far enough, but if they have the ability to read, upload, your this life, the life you're in when you die, and your soul flies, if they have the ability to upload or take out the assimilated information that they need, the assimilated narrative information that you assimilated while you're alive, that they need to show you what they need to show you in order to get your soul to reconsent to another loop, then why would we think that they don't have that ability while we're even alive? So yeah, you're right. They very well could, because of different narratives. I've always wondered if the people who believe they were abducted by quote unquote aliens are always people who to some extent had some assimilated data about that. Like, is that something that they were really kind of into? Did they read books about it? Did they know someone else that supposedly went through it and then started studying it, and thereby, you know, assimilating that information, thus allowing that information to be utilized against you when they took you? So did they actually take the body as well? Because what I didn't say was, which is a question for me, because what I didn't, the detail I left out, was I believe on the third time that I wound up somewhere else, I was in that house, and I can't remember what it was that happened, because I believe it happened when I wasn't actually looking and in a particular direction, but something happened to the front of my lower right leg, and it hurt really freaking bad, and I woke up in my bed, wide awake, you know, jerked my head looking around, but immediately felt this massive right leg pain, right where I felt it when I was there. And I felt that pain, and I grabbed my leg in bed and tried to kind of roll out of bed and look, because the pain was there, and it was there for about 15, 20 seconds, and it was really bad. That gets me wondering if the people who believe they were abducted were actually physically abducted, or were their souls just transported somewhere else, given that experience for whatever reason, and then put back.
Now, this is real. Again, this is kind of common. And I've even experienced this where I've woken up from what you would call an abduction type dream with marks on my body. Other people have reported waking up in the morning with marks on their body after they had the sense that they had been pulled out of their bodies. And what some of the people in our field have speculated is that whatever occurred with the astral body, the was in fact impacting on the physical body. So, I mean, as creepy and strange as all of that sounds, a physical mark, a physical injury on the body is another one of these hallmarks of these type experiences.
Yeah, and again, I could lend, you know, another occurrence. This has happened to me 3 times in my life, but has nothing to do with aliens or anything like that. But it again, I paused to get into it. But there was not too many years ago, maybe 3 years ago. I hadn't gotten sick at all, maybe in the last 10 years, except for once about 3 years ago. And then I think, the week that we did this show number 6, I had a bad cold, but other than that, I rarely ever sick. And I got something, boy, I'll tell you what, about 3 years ago that, even the doctor, you know, he was like, well, you know, I don't know. He just gave me a zithromycin to try to kill it off. And the next step was going to be Cipro, because it was kicking my butt, and I don't know where I possibly got it, but it was stopping me from breathing. It was horrific. It was really bad. And in about the middle of it or so, I went to bed one night and I could hardly breathe. I felt so bad and so ill that I literally could hardly breathe. I had to lay on my side even to breathe at all. If I laid on my back, I couldn't breathe. And I prayed. I asked the Heer to please, you know, heal me, because I don't think I'm going to make it through tonight. I really didn't. I've put it a few times in my life where I actually didn't think I was going to make it through that night. And I just asked for that. And I woke up the next morning and my shirt was off, which, you know, I always sleep with a T-shirt. So, and I never take it off. So there, it was odd that my shirt was off. And it was hanging somewhere where I never hang it. It was just very strange. And I woke up and I felt completely better. I felt 100% better, like nothing was wrong with me. And I thought, wow, I can't believe I feel so good. You know, I can breathe. I felt not sick, nothing in my nostrils, nothing in my lungs, nothing. And I got up. I went into my master bedroom, my bathroom, and to brush my teeth. I'm standing in front of the mirror. And I see this redness on my almost on a large section of my right chest and around, like wrapped around my right upper arm. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, what the hell is that? You know, I thought it was like a rash or something. It was pretty red. And as I look closer, you know, you can easily see, actually, as my eyes, you know, because I just woke up, you can see that it was a giant handprint on my chest. And it was large. I mean, large. I would have to guess that it would be from, you know, if it was a person's handprint, the person would be 10 to 12 feet tall, I would guess. Really large handprint. And the other handprint, which just looked red around the front of my arm, but when you looked around the back of my arm, you can see the fingers. They wrapped all the way around my arm. And I got my son, and I showed him, and he couldn't believe it. He's like, what the hell is that? And we looked at it, and I went back and laid in bed, and I asked him, I said, all right, look at it. What does it look like? And he said, it looks like, he said, it's exactly, if I put, he said, from standing next to you in the bed, if I put my right hand on your chest and my left hand wrapped around your upper arm, that's what it is. And, well, there you have it. That wasn't aliens. That was my father who did that. And that has happened two other times before when I was actually hurt pretty bad in another place where there was nobody else to really help me. And same type of thing happened, no handprints, but, you know, boom. I woke up and I felt something all over my body, very warm, like, and had finite edges. I remember that I was awake, felt it. It had finite edges, right and left, top to bottom, like a blanket almost. And that happened two times, that in two different scenarios where I was really at my wit's end in bad physical condition because of events, and was laying there, and that happened about 2-3 in the morning. I woke up because I felt it, and then I went back to sleep, and the next morning I woke up without a pain in my body and not a mark on me. So I know that the Creator exists. I know that His messengers probably exist. This is probably what's happened, but this other thing we're talking about is very different. And because I've had, and the only reason I'm saying this is I don't view these as supernatural events like everybody else would generally. They would get very excited about it and talk about it, and I've only maybe told my wife, my son, and one other person about this, and until now. And the only reason why I do is because I want people to understand that I don't even see that as a supernatural event. No more of a supernatural event than if my own son was hurt or something was wrong, that I would do whatever it took to fix him. So that's not really a supernatural event. This other stuff which is happening also is not a supernatural event. It's an evil event based on technology utilizing the supernatural ability or disability of our souls to know or not know what's happening to them. So, I mean, I guess to, you know, put that finer point on it again, just as a warning that if this is happening, which I'm absolutely sure it must be, to other people, regardless of where they're going or what they're seeing when they get there, to understand that it's not a dream and you need to unconsent to the whole thing and use whatever you believe in to get out. And if what you believe in is not getting you out, then you need to change what you believe in and use, you know, like I said, when I talked to the other people that this happened to, I don't have any other understanding of how to get out of such a thing other than, you know, my Creator's name as it was given and to unconsent. And that's the only two things I know, and which seemed to work with me. It seemed to work with them because they came back and said that it worked with them. So that's great. Some people would argue with me and say, well, you know, God's name could be different, and, you know, the Creator's name could be different in many different languages, and it, you know, this and that other thing, or it could be just this or that. Well, you know, that's one argument, but, you know, is the F word just different in every language? No. It's the same word. I know, because I've traveled all over the world, and
yeah,
and
it's universally understood.
Yeah, and I learned quick when I was young traveling that guess what? If I'm having a problem with somebody and I really want to get under their skin, and they're speaking a completely different language, and you know, and we're having a problem, if I just use that word at them, well, then it's on. You know. As a young man, I learned that pretty quick. That,
yeah,
you know, I don't care where I was, wherever they were speaking. If I say that, everybody gets the point. you know. So I don't believe that. I believe, you know, people say, well, you know, this, that, your thing. Well, I think the Indian culture, I think the Buddhist culture, I think the ancient Hebrew culture all have the same name. I've found it. It's all very, you know, very close. And it's always been there. It's the only name that's always been there. You know, I've done a lot of research on that. And there's many other names, there's many other attributes that people that were given that people think are names. Christians are especially horribly misled on that, and different things like that. But there is only one. When you take the etymology of that and go back and back and back, there is only one that has always existed and stayed and did not change and did not get reattributed to anything else or whatever. It is also, by the way, the only one that, guess who, you know, worked so diligently for the last 5,000 years to hide. It's the only one. There's no other name. Brahma, it doesn't matter. There's no other name that they have worked so diligently to hide. And to me, that's proof in and of itself. You know, it's kind of the thing, if the Vatican wants it, then I know I hate it. Or if the Shelonite Orthodoxy wants it, I know I hate it, right? I don't even have to know why they want it or what they want about it or what they know about it. Is as soon as I know that evil entity wants it, I know I'm the opposite, right? And so that has to play into what people believe and what, you know. So if this isn't working for you, whatever you got going isn't working for you, then you need to change it up, because whatever they're doing, I firmly believe now that they're trying to acclimate souls, and they're just letting them tacitly consent for longer periods. And that would be a very sublime way to do it, rather than scare the crap at everybody, which may or may not work. You know, I mean, is it going to work in America, armed to the teeth? If they start flying around in their little, you know, jets and hovercrafts and start, you know, shooting some beams down and blowing up some buildings or whatever, you know, scaring them. No, there's going to be a whole lot of, you know, guys out there shooting back. And then guess what? Some of that stuff's going to fall out of the sky. And then they're going to go look, and they're going to say, hey, this guy's got an Air Force uniform on. Then it's all over. See, there's a lot to that probably won't work. And they probably know that. They probably know when push comes to shove, you know, white supremacist, this one, that one, whoever it is in his basement with his singular javelin missile or whatever he stole from some army base 10 years ago, he's got hidden, you know, they're going to come hovering over and get blown right out of the sky. And all of a sudden, everybody's going to know it's not real. See, so there's a lot of risk to that game, to that idea. I bought into it for a long time that was probably the way, and I do believe that they had that on their mind, that was the way they were going to try to get everyone to consent to something. You know, and then we find through the years now that what they want people to consent to is to literally going somewhere else. And I figured, well, the fear factor is going to be how they're going to do it. But, you know, the more you think about it, the more that you'll start seeing with that program that, it, you know, if you're logical about it and you're real about it and you take in all the consideration about it, I mean, yeah, go ahead, do that over Yemen, see what happens next, right? Or, you know, do that over Arkansas, Tennessee, yeah. Montana, see what happens next. There's more 50 caliber sniper rifles sold into Montana than any other place in the world. I saw that on actual ATF records. All right. So what's going to happen when they come over with their little hovercraft and try that? See. So I can see that someone might have, you know, with a brain among them might have said that. Might have said, you know, it's an idea, but there's a lot that can go wrong with that. So, and maybe the higher ups, the archons, the ones who are ruling them, said the same thing. I don't know. But this seems to be a much more sublime way to do it, to just keep transporting you and letting you stay there, letting you acclimate there. You know, I found it a little odd that if they were populating another place, wouldn't they populate it with identical, with, I, you know, we talked about this last time on the last show, that, that they were probably populating. That's why they're taking so much or collecting so much intimate data into their databases and whatever, is because they need that data to repopulate or to populate that, that new matrix. So that, you know, you, in other words, see my mind, if I was doing this, I would make your house identical or as identical as I could, so that when I took you there, right, you didn't pop in to some other old Victorian house that you've never seen before, all right? Now, of course, strangely enough, you know, I tend, you know, if I had my druthers, you know, I would always live in an old house like that. I grew up in a house like that. And I would live in an old house. I like old houses, and maybe that's why. Maybe that's what they took and utilized. That's the only conclusion I come to with that. Because if I was doing it, I wouldn't do that. I would populate it identically as I could. And maybe they are. Maybe I got popped into the wrong place. I don't know. But I would make it so that you popped into your own bed, so that you just woke up thinking that you were having a little dream. But here you are. You're in the same, relatively close, identically to the same surroundings, then you wouldn't think much of it, right? And for all I know, that's what's happening with other people. Or maybe not, like you said, maybe they're using the assimilated data that's in each person, right, that's most prominent, and sucking them in to the other matrix for a little while, and doing that. I don't know that
Look at the average person today, and I'll use this example because it's one that kind of grinds on me. The number of people that drink artificially sweetened soft drinks, for instance. Now, to me, when I don't drink soda, but if I were to pick a soda up, the first thing that would hit me would be if it was artificially sweetened, because I can taste it. I can taste the bitter taste. But
yeah.
People have become assimilated to it, so it became as acceptable as using, we'll call it, more natural form of sweetener, such as sugar. And what has happened is, over time, the collective consciousness, the matrix people, the people who are now trending towards null and void if they're not careful, or if they already are not null and void, are being lulled into a place where the synthetic is indiscernible from the real. So the simulacrum that they've erected, while it's kind of a cheap substitute, seems to work on a statistical basis most of the time. And right. that's how you tell the difference. The genuine from the real, you know, it's like banks teach their tellers to discern counterfeit money by handling real money, so that
right.
they know
right.
the difference. It becomes ingrained into you. So if you don't have contact with the real, the synthetic becomes an incredibly good substitute, and in some cases, it's perfect.
Well, in that case, it wouldn't be a substitute anymore if you've never been in contact with the real.
Right.
So, yeah, exactly. And like you were saying in that document, and like I said in the book, if you tacitly consent long enough and agree, you know, individually, like you said, once we individually and collectively agree, creation will not interfere. Why? Because of free will. So they're going to be allowed. So, you know, it's funny because that alleged scripture pops into mind, if those days were not shortened, right? So,
right. The very elect themselves would be deceived. Yeah.
Right, right. And it's very interesting. But, yeah, that's exactly right, man. You get people used to one thing enough, and that's why I thought to come out publicly and admit to this, because that would be just like I thought, a very sublime way to do it would be to pull souls in, you know, periodically and for longer and longer periods of time, and get them acclimated to the other. Because maybe scaring the crap out of everybody under those insane circumstances of, you know, some I don't think nuclear war would do that. I don't think they can get people to consent after a nuclear war, during a nuclear war, or during a mock nuclear war, since I don't actually believe nukes exist as people believe they do. And or an alien invasion or something else. You know, so would a giant tsunami do that? No, because a giant tsunami will wipe out the people that you're trying to get there anyway. So that doesn't help. You know, a war using massive bombs, taking out cities and whatever, that's not going to help, because that just wipes out the people that, you know, boom, and then they're just automatically recycled through their main system to begin with. And evidently, there's some disconnect between that system and this new system. Or they would just kill everybody off somehow, let the souls go up into their false heaven matrix system, and then from there, inject them into the new one. All right, but I don't believe that can happen, because once your soul is out of this body and fully aware of itself, it's not going to consent, or there's some other difficulties to doing that, or else it would already be done. We wouldn't even be having this conversation. This seems to be a more sublime way to do it, would be to just get them in, like you're saying, whether it's sucrose or sugar. You know, they're not... It's close enough, and if they allow themselves to stay there, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 2 hours, 5 hours, whatever, one of those times you're not coming back. And maybe that's the other people I saw there. Maybe that's why they were clinging to me. They were coming to me. They were trying to get my attention. They were saying things to me. They were all talking at once. They were definitely agitated that something was wrong, but they were there. And then the next time, they were there. And then the next time, they were there. Well, what the hell are they doing there? I was leaving, like, pretty quick. So why were they still there? I'm thinking because maybe they've allowed it to happen too many times and they can't get back. They don't know how. So now the key is, which the other side does not want anyone to find out, is how to get back, how to return. What's the key? How to return. That's the key. Consent and possibly the use of the name, but possibly not. Just definitely consent. I mean, there's no doubt about that. There's no doubt about that. Verbally and loudly unconsenting to being there to anything, that has to be first and foremost on the tip of your tongue. But, geez, man, how do we know? You know, what if those people just can't get back already, or they don't know how to get back? I'm not going back there, so now they're screwed. I mean, if they're stuck in that house, who's going to tell them? Because I'm not going back. I'm not even taking a chance. You know, so I'm not that much of a hero. So this is a pretty invasive and scary thing when you really start thinking about it in depth. So I think everybody should take this as a warning, whether they believe it or not, or know it. At least, even if you don't believe it, at least know that the possibility exists. So if it ever does happen, then at least you'll have it. You'll have the information in your mind, you know, you'll have it. Because you are who you are when you get there. So everything that you know now, you'll know then. Which is, you know, I found pretty amazing. So that's how I knew it was me. You know, I don't know what else to say on the subject. Just, I think you have a lot to say on it.
I have said a lot on it. You know, this is a subject that I have talked about a lot. You know what strikes me when we were talking? We've been warned about this for a long time. I don't know if you recall the original Twilight Zone series from the 1960s or not. With Rod Serling. Well, there's a very famous episode, and I'm thinking this came out in 1962 or so. I mean, I saw these things in reruns continuously. The name of the episode's called To Serve Man, and it has to do with a group of 9-foot aliens that land on the planet and begin to offer people trips to their home planet, which they describe as a paradise. And they proffer this book. It's called To Serve Man. And at some point...
Ah, yeah, I've seen that one. Yeah, yeah. I know where you're going. Go
ahead. Yeah, Rod Serling was brilliant. In a 30-minute TV show, he could weave a lot into a narrative. But, we'll do the buzzkill here. The end of the story is, at the end of it, you've got all these people lined up getting ready to climb in this spaceship, thinking that they were going off to paradise, and one person's down below. He read the book. It says to serve men, and he goes, "You wait a minute, it's a cookbook." And yeah, that's what this is. You know, it's kind of humorous. Yeah. You know, if you look at the show, it's kind of cheesy. I mean, we've gotten better at portraying aliens over the decades. But the message behind it's pretty much the same, is that whatever deceptions you fall for, that's tacit consent to walk into your own death trap.
Right. Because why? Because no one asks which God.
That's right. Yeah.
It keeps going back to that. Nobody asks which God. Oh, God will save me. God, 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 God. You know, but nobody asks which God. Nobody asks to serve man. What is this? What kind of book is this? That's a good one. I remember that. That's pretty funny. It was a cookbook. Yeah, yeah. Well, there you go. Same exact story, same exact line.
Yep, we've been warned for a long time, from the ancient texts to modern entertainment.
Yeah, and that's why it's so important, because it is verifiable from ancient sources that most have been hidden or long forgotten or dead languages and whatnot, but it's the same exact story, and all the reformatting that has been done here, the overlay, you know, from the beginning till today, has all been geared towards one, you know, final solution, you know, which is to cut all the souls off, completely cut them off, because we're not cut off, like I show in the book, we're not cut off. But I got to tell you, man, brought up the idea of how many souls are actually here versus how many humanoid physical beings are actually walking around, I've had a hard time for not thinking about that. I did go and look, as you did, a little bit, not to study, you probably did with it, but I looked at the population from, you know, what, 100 years ago and whatnot, and 150 years ago, and then, like you said, when you take into account natural disasters, famines, plagues, wars, population reductions through ethnic cleansing, and you know, in all that time, in just the last 100 years, and then throw on top of that what we now have pretty good statistics on, which is the quickly declining birth rate of the Western civilization peoples. You're right. I just don't believe you can get the six and a half billion people already in that amount of time, factoring in all that. So then I have to ask, why do they want us to believe there's that many people on a planet? And then when we take into consideration their concept of 7 billion minds, the computing power that they're talking about with whatever their D-Wave computer and stuff like that, that eludes me a little bit, because that kind of goes away. You know, maybe, or maybe there is 6.5 billion, but they're not all. I know there's other people who
sentient.
Believe this. They're not all souled in the
right
way.
That's kind of where I was going with this. Can I actually prove the numbers? I can't prove them or disprove them. My intuition tells me those numbers are a stretch based on all the factors that we outlined before. Having said that, there are some strong hints that re-engineering of humanity has been an ongoing process going back to the fallen ones. And creating...
about.
Yeah, and creating synthetics is not difficult. I mean, everything from the legends of the Nephilim to the Golem that were part of the ancient Hebrew history we have artificial life forms on any number of levels. So when you layer that into a simulated reality stream, and the way I've come to look at it is I can't prove or disprove, and it's not my place to judge. My sense is a lot of what's going on around us are just software programs that are running in the matrix as background, like walk-on actors on a movie set.
Well, and you would need that population and growing population of something, whether they're real or not, in order to set the stage for the ones who you're really trying to capture. You know, now whether they're, you know, 144,000 only or some expansion of that, I don't know. You know, that is a hard number to take literally. But
it may not be, though. What if, you know, and this sounds horrible, and, you know, if you construe what I say the wrong way, you could turn me into a eugenicist in half a second. But what if the original souls and the children of those souls, or what are called the children of men, are the targets, and everything else around us is a simulation? Because remember, we're building this collective consensus reality on an ongoing basis. All of it's being run by media. All of it is being run now in digital binary streams. So a lot of the collective consensus reality is fabricated Hollywood images to begin with, which pulls people into this trap.
Right, and it's funny you should bring that up, because the idea of certain souls in these Trinity Six bodies, and then they create other children, right? That's something I've given a lot of thought to, and it's funny because as crazy as a lot of them are, or their doctrine is, the Mormons also have this kind of an idea going on.
Yeah, they do.
And like all of Christianity, they pull the truthful parts out, and then it's been obscured, or the superstitious stuff has been layered on so much that they've lost where it is. But I go back to Abraham. I go back to him, and I look at that, and I don't look at it because in my Asher Torah, which I'm still working on, I go through and I'm going through every sentence, every word. And when you do that, a lot of it changes. As you know, you saw from the soul revelation when I went through Genesis chapter 1. It changes a lot.
It does.
You know, when you read it, when you read it after that, you're like, holy shit, now that makes sense. You know, and anyone who's read the first couple of renditions, the first workthroughs of my Asher Torah, in Genesis, they've all come back and said, wow, okay, now I understand what's going on. Now that made a lot more sense. But there is a point talking about, Abraham, okay, which is not how you say his name, but I'll just use that because that's how everybody understands him. He was given a mandate, okay, but the mandate was not to make his name great. That was greatly reworded in all the translations. The mandate was to make Ahia's name great, not Abraham's name great. Okay, and when you start looking at that, and you start looking at everything that was said to him after the fact, you also have to look at the text, because there's a lot of redundancies in that text. In the Genesis text regarding Abraham, and when you start getting into that, you start seeing that are they redundancies? Yeah, they are. There's doublets and triplets of certain stories and certain things, but the main thing you'll see is that there was another entity that was talking to him as well, who was trying to lead him slightly off the original path, and he did. He almost got it. He almost got him. Why? How? Abraham didn't sacrifice things. Okay, he had already lived and been taught through the house of Noah directly. So he knew. He did not sacrifice things. The story of Abraham and his father, who owned an idol store, I guess is what you would call it, a bazaar, is both in the ancient Hebrew and both also in the ancient Islamic writings. Both it's the same story, and it's just basically shows that Abraham knew what not to do. This is why he was chosen. He wasn't so much chosen; he was built, in other words, from a young man to learn the correct way of the everlasting agreement and move it forward. So all the stuff you read about him in there, where it lends to him killing animals or eating animals or this, it is all been manipulated, and it's not that many portions or areas, but it's all been manipulated until you get to the alleged story of him sacrificing his son, which, by the way, was never taught after it happened. That's a very important point that most people never even think of, is the boy it happened to, right, Yitzhak, never spoke about it, never used it as a teaching tool. His sons never spoke about it, never used it as a teaching tool. Even David never spoke about it. Moshe never spoke about it, used it as a teaching tool. It just disappeared. And as I like to say, fish stories get bigger over time. They certainly don't disappear. So we have all this in there, but whether it happened or not doesn't matter. If it did, it was the influence of the other God. And it's important to understand what I see through this is what his mandate was, what he was given, wasn't just a mandate, but he was actually given. And when you look at his blessing, again, the blessing is not to make a certain people great, special, or in charge. It is only to make and expand the character, the truth, the way, the persona of the Creator himself. That's what that blessing is about. And it's very important in this context that we're talking about, because I coined it as the beacon seed, beacon, B-E-A-C-O-N, beacon seed, that somehow, and I don't, believe me, know how, okay, I don't understand how this could be, the science behind it. I just believe that this is what occurred because of all the other information before it and after it that we have, and based on the blessing itself, okay, which, again, does not make a certain people greater than anyone else. It, what it's doing, which is how it's been used, as we all know. So what I call the beacon seed is what I believe was done through Abraham. I believe that he was changed. I believe Abram, okay, was Abram. I believe Abraham was made great and changed. Literally, on the cellular level, I believe he was changed. And I believe that his seed, right, which I call the beacon seed, all right, went through and kept multiplying. I believe it is something that does not degradate. I believe if I pass it on to my son, or you pass it on to your son, and he passes it on, and he passes on, and the next one passes on, that it does not do what DNA generally will do if not added to as it goes, right? Is that the gene pool isn't mixed a little further down the line. I believe that's what the blessing was, because if that is not what it is, then it's all BS, period. Because for his seed, all right, to be as the stars of the sky and of the heavens and the sands of the sea, that would be like inserting an antiviral. And what I mean by this is, based on what you're saying, what you tend to believe, that archons have been creating Trinity 6 bodies, like the one I'm in presently, okay, then, and if they are creating them and somehow animating them with some sort of soul portion or in some way, they're animating those physical bodies, they're not, like you're saying, what everyone believes they are. They're not creator, they're not filled with a portion, a micro portion of the macro creator soul. This is what we're saying, which I know sounds insane. So, but if that is the case, which it could be, that they created these automatons, and you know, which are the people that we run into most of our lives, which no matter how much truth you show them, even in black and white, they will not accept it. It doesn't go in. Okay, it doesn't go in because there's nothing to go into. That could be the case. My point with the beacon seed is that it's almost like an antiviral infection in and of itself, whereas the creator understood, saw what was happening, this place is being reformatted, it's even being filled with drones. Okay, let's just call them drones. But the drones have the ability, possibly, to be infected in such a way that their soul portion be completed. And if that's the case, then that beacon seed, which I call the beacon seed from Abraham, being passed on and passed on and passed on, does not divide, does not lose its power or its ability. And when it goes into, as we mix, right? And what did the Shelonites say not to do? What was one of their God's biggest laws? They're a law that still to this day is kept, is not to mingle with the Gentiles, with anyone else outside of their own, clique or, you know, their own gene pool. So that's still going on. And that's still a major portion of their law. Why? It would only serve to degrade your gene pool. That makes no sense. It only makes sense if, by doing so, you're stopping everyone, right? Because what did you do? You told, you infected this other Babylonian religion that they later called Catholicism, and you taught them also to not marry unless it's a Catholic, another Catholic. And this idea, not that that would really change much, but this idea is strewn pretty much throughout most cultures, right? It's lessening. But the idea here is that this seed, this beacon seed, then gets in and gets in and gets in and just keeps perpetuating. It keeps being perpetuated. And by doing so, it's, think of it like this, like a man like yourself or myself that has it, okay, marries a drone because, for all intents and purposes, there are, you know, you can't tell, really. They're drones on most levels. So as soon as you do, what have you done? You inject that seed, you inject that DNA, which where that beacon seed is that was given to Abraham. And now that child, like you just brought up, comes out the other side, lit up. What does the creator see when he looks down into this snow globe of creation? How do any of them know who's who? Possibly that you're lit up. That That's why I call it the beacon seat, because that now infects the drone, and out the other side comes one that's not a drone. I know it sounds crazy, but when you look at the facts, they're alleged to be facts within the Hebrew text about Abraham especially, and the whole blessing, and how the blessing was utilized by the false ones to subvert the blessing, to subvert the whole understanding of the blessing. See, so like I said before, if I know the Shelonites, if I know the Catholics, whoever, want this, then I know automatically without knowing anything about it that I don't want it. Right? It's opposite day for me. So it's the same thing. When I look at what they've done with that, all the way through Jacob, right? The alleged fight with the angel, and we overcome God, which they plainly state. I just can't even believe they plainly state it, but they plainly state that they don't listen to God, the Creator, any longer, because they overcame him. Plainly stated in Orthodox Judaism. But again, in my Asher Codex and in other books, I prove those texts, and I prove through many other texts after that is not what that says, and that is not what happened. It's all a lie. But it had to be done there because it was also done to Abraham. It was also done to Abram. So to continue that line of thinking, they had to change that, and they've had to change other nuances after that. There isn't much on that line, but that's what they've had to do. Why? Why did they do that? Because of this. Because the truth of this is amazing and powerful, if this is in fact the truth of the beacon seed. So this is what I see. So I think you're totally correct when you say that that certain sentient, you can't say sentient because even the drones are sentient. Even the ones that do have the original souls, if that's what you want to call them, then for that, for any of this to go forward or to save the other ones who were made, who are sentient, we will call them drones for now, but they are sentient. So something's got to be in there. So if something's got to be in there, it maybe is a small portion of other souls. Maybe that's why all these near-death experience or past life regression people have stated that when they're up in the false matrix, that they see that their soul is actually in thirds and three parts, and that two-thirds is stuck there, up there, or held prisoner, and that only one-third is here. So I posited in my book that, well, it's probably not stuck there. Those other two-thirds are probably used somewhere else. Is that what they're using for the other drones? The other two-thirds, or maybe they break it up more. In other words, just enough to animate the other ones, to make them sentient, but not allow that full tether to the Creator. Then thus, the beacon seed infects them. Maybe it even changes them. Maybe it allows him to complete them at that point, plus any offspring that comes out of them. That would be how you heal the world. That would be how everything that they've done would come to nothing. That could be a way. I mean, just to say that another prophet did it, or as I believe the elect one, Yeshua, just to say he did it. Well, maybe he did. Maybe it was his plan. I mean, who knows? But it's something's been done. Something on this line is in the text. It's strewn throughout. And also by the mere fact that we see how they've subverted those specific texts and others specifically, and how they specifically subverted them to be something else, also tells you what you need to know. It's just as much proof as the other. So this is all has to be put together, and that's what I came up with a while back. Is the demon seed? I mean, I'm sorry, you got the demon seed, right? But the beacon seed, and another thing that's, as I taught this to someone, recently brought up, the correlation, as I used in the new book, Yeshua's parable of the wheat and darnel, or wheat and tares, right? And I use that in the book along this line because it's very important. And now, but now when you think of the beacon seed idea, and if you think of Abraham being changed at the cellular level, and then everything emanating from him, clearing up the acne, so to say, as it goes, and continually throughout all time and to the end, which is the only way, because remember, all living and all dead, where everybody says, well, you know, the sands of the sea and the stars of the heavens, there's only 6 billion people on the planet, there's way more stars than that. All right, you want to be a little, you know, take it literally. Think about all the people between you alive today as you take it literally to the beginning. Think of all of them. Okay, so it's a lot more. So when we bring all that, and we look at Yeshua when he was talking about the wheat and the tares is really a very bad translation. And it's, I use that in the book, but you can correlate it to the beacon seed as well, because, and maybe even more, because the tares in the Hebrew, they'd be using the word darnel, which is an agricultural Hebrew word, which is more important than tares. It has, like all those Hebrew words, has a much greater meaning. It allows you to think differently. When you hear the word, you think of a completely different thing. So the tares, what is that? In English, people think, or a farmer thinks, the tares is just stuff that's cut off and thrown out. Okay, that's just what that is. But when we look at what he was saying, what he was trying to get across, might be connected to this, what I call the beacon seed, because the wheat and the darnel, the Hebrew, more specifically, paints a picture. It would be to describe the word, it would be a plant, okay, that looks nearly identical to the wheat in every aspect and grows up like a weed in and around the wheat, i.e. the drones, right? So the darnel would be the drones. They look just like everyone else. The wheat looks identical. The darnel looks identical to wheat. And it's very difficult, if not impossible, to weed out. So they just let it all grow together, and then at the end, it's weeded out and burned. Okay, so and you don't know until the end, because at the end, when wheat ripens, the head of the wheat dips down. Okay, and like it's bowing, as they say in the idea of the Hebrew, towards the Creator, and the darnel does not. And that's where you can see the difference. And so maybe we can look at what Yeshua was saying as the wheat and the darnel, as the darnel being the drones that are in and among all the rest. And there will be some, and this is in every generation, of course, the Christians look at this and say, well, you know, this is just an end time prophecy. And as I explained it in the new book, Soul Revolution, that it's obviously not, because no cycle of harvesting anything is one time. Even in 1 year, it's multiple crops. It's multiple cycles. And then you have annual
cycles.
That's
a great distinction, by the way. Thank you. I like that.
Yeah, and you know, when you talk to Christians, they're like, oh, this is a one-time prophecy. No, there's no way he was talking about this as a one-time prophecy, because he's using crops. Do crops only grow one time? No. So, yes, will there be a one-time end? Yes. So is he talking about both? Yes. And that's how you have to look at this. And I think that's what he was trying to show everyone, that this is, there's a certain seed, a good seed. I mean, he'd even had that, right? The farmer or whoever throws his seed, some falls on rocks, some falls here, some falls there, some gets eaten by the birds, some grows on good ground, and blah, 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 blah. I mean, I've heard that one a zillion times. So, again, it's the same thing. He's trying to tell you the same thing, that some of that seed is special, and some of it winds up unspecial for one reason or another. And so in every generation, maybe that beacon seed is infecting more and more of the darnel, the drones, which look exactly like you in every generation. And which, again, which in my mind would be why they would need to, you know, kill off and start another epoch every now and then, because we get to this point where we are now, where a lot of us are trying to wake everyone else up and tell them, hey, this is there's something a lot more going on here, and if you want to get out, X, Y, and Z, you know. So it's so I would expect some pretty bad stuff to start happening in the near future, probably while we're still alive. But yeah, I thought that was a good point. We brought that up, that their children, you know, might be this or that, and that just hit me on the head, because that's the beacon seed thing. I think has a lot of merit, and I think when the Creator looks down, that's what he sees: beacons. And they're probably quite a lot now. I don't understand where the 144,000 literally comes in, but that could be the original, like you said. That doesn't mean that's all that's there or left or changed. It could be just the original. And the original ones might be, for a long time, the population has grown and been infected with the beacon seed from Abraham for a long time. And maybe there's very few drones left. Yeah, maybe there's not that many that we think at all, because there's been a lot of mingling going on. I would think that there are certain sectors of the earth that you can point to, Japan and China being two, that, well, you can't know for sure either with them, but it's a lot of people who have tended not to mingle much with Westerners or Easterners. So, you know, there's something to be thought about there. But it's, I would think, for the vast majority of people on the planet, that probably most of it has been most of it has been infected with the, or however you want to call it, inoculated with the other. And I think that's pretty interesting to think about. But so that 144,000 might be literal, but it might not be all there is. That's all I'm saying. And maybe, again, if you look at my first book, Lamb and Honey, I go into what I think is very important is the elect one. And if you go way back into Enoch, it very clearly states that there are two peoples, that there is a smaller sect that is righteous in the Creator's eyes because they follow the path, the instructions, it says, of the Creator. And then there's a multitude called the elect who follow the elect one, mm-hmm. who are not righteous,
yeah.
because they do not follow the path of the Creator. So, but the elect one has to be the one covering them. So see, this all fits into the whole Yeshua, Jesus narrative of him being in a covering agent, or like I like to call him, a covering agent, or intermediary. Intermediary is okay, but I think a covering agent's better for those drones, for those ones who are not drones any longer, possibly, and probably, and if we have to look at it like that, like you're saying, and but again, not far enough along to get to this point to believe the simplicity of the original path and this kind of thing. So they need that covering, which is great. They have it. I think that's great, and I think that's what he does. I think there's a lot of proof I put in Asher Codex and my first book about him. And about his legitimacy, and about, you know, no different than I think what Buddha taught, Brahma, and you know, things like that. So it's a lot of the same information to a certain point, and I think he was a little bit more profound than the rest. You know, that's just my opinion. But I think it's a really good thought that you had there, that that the children could be, you know, not drones. It's interesting.
We tied a lot of things together, or we cast a lot of threads. I'm not sure which. But, you know, the phenomenon that we talked about for most of this show is a common touchstone for a lot of people out there. And I think, unless you've got something else you want to toss in at this point, we've probably given people a lot to chew on and consider until we revisit all of this in the next show.
No, I'm good.
And thanks, by the way, for sharing what you shared. That's not an easy thing to do. But you're in good company. There's a lot of people out there that have had these types and similar experiences. And each time that we put this information out, I know you're going to hear from people out there that are hearing this. I will as well. We're reinforcing each other in our experiences, and also at the same time kind of working through the process in a way that we have a positive outcome rather than just feeling like we're losing it.
Right. Yeah. I'm just expanding the knowledge base, and you know, a lot of the Darnell gets thrown away and a lot of the wheat gets kept, and we bring it to a finer point as we go. That's, you know, not one person can generally have all the answers. And although I think, like I always say, that the truth is super simple. And if you need a special priest or a hidden way that you can't know it, or they got to teach it, or only they can have it, or whatever the case, then you know that's the lie. But the truth is always super simple. And I think that's important for people to remember, because, you know, we tend to really muddy the waters and want to take something that's really simple, a simple path, and just pile all kinds of other crap on top of it, because that's what people like. They like, you know, they like ritual. They like ritual. They like, you know, all those customary doodads and trinkets, and but it doesn't need to be like that. It's just a lot a lot simpler, and it's difficult for people to take simple for some reason. And so that would be my advice to everybody, to keep things really simple and know that the truth is super simple. It's never difficult, never intricate. It's just not. And, you know, that's important to know. And the only other thing I wanted to say was just to apologize to people that have emailed me, and that, I mean, I don't know what we said in the last show, the fifth show. I was not feeling good. I was coming out of a stupor of being having a bad cold for about a week when we did that show, and I was kind of repeating myself after I listened to it. I thought, wow, this, I didn't like it at all, but I don't know what we said, but boy, I got a major influx of emails within a couple of days, the first 2 days of people listening to that, and I just couldn't keep up with answering all the emails. I got people mixed up and answering the wrong thing to the wrong person. So, you know, I just want to apologize to everybody for that, because I was just, with all the other stuff I do generally, teaching and fielding phone calls and writing papers and books and things like that, I'm trying to get all those emails out, so I'll get them out as fast as I can, but just wanted to apologize to some of the people that I got kind of crossed up. That's it.
Actually, you know, our listeners know that they're going through a process, and they know this is all done. We're not editing a whole lot of these shows, and so it kind of comes the way it was put together. So that's part and parcel of the whole package and the whole experience. So, you know, no apologies necessary. We just put it out, and I think there's a resonance frequency there that people responded to. So, as always, people can find you at AncientHebrewLearningCenter.blogspot.com. You have any new articles or things going up right now, Shmuel?
Yeah, I threw something up the other day. I think I sent to you. So there's one new thing, and I think I am going to put that older teaching of the letter L in Hebrew, Lamed, because it does pertain to some of this, what we're talking about. talking about. So I'll have something else up there within the next couple. Well,
yeah, keep me updated. We'll put the link up with the show. And thanks for coming on today and sharing all of this, Shmuel. That's going to wrap it up for this time, TriUnity series. This is episode 7. We'll be back with another one very soon. The truth is out there, and it's really simple. Bye.